to see y'all here with us. We're so excited that you've come out in a rainy day to worship with us. So we want to welcome y'all to Riverbluff, those of y'all who are here and online as well. If this is your first time here, please know there is an extra special gift waiting for you at the main entrance right over there, and we are so glad that you've joined us. Before we continue on in worship, I want to share a scripture with us. So this is from Matthew 7, 24 and 25. This is how Jesus ends the Sermon on the Mount, the greatest sermon ever told. He says, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock." And that's our prayer for our church as a whole. That's our prayer for us as individuals this morning, that we would be founded on the truth and the person of Jesus Christ. So we ask you to continue to worship with us.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, and everything around me shaken. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful to generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. I've still got joy. We'll be right back.
God, He is so good. We worship You, God. We thank You. We come now. We come praising You in song. But even more importantly, in spirit, God, we come. We want to worship You in spirit and in truth, oh God. And we thank You for Your goodness. Your goodness draws us to Yourself. Your goodness that sees us in our sin, broken condition, and moves toward us, beckoning us into life with You. And so we come once again. We come confessing, God, our own bent towards sin, thanking You, Jesus, that You paid the penalty for that on Calvary's cross. Thanking You that You were buried in that borrowed tomb. That was part of Your goodness. But oh, so thankful that You didn't stay there, that You got up out of that grave, that You rose. And that is a promise of our own coming resurrection if we've put our trust in You, Jesus. And so we come worshiping You, all of Your goodness, thanking You. We also come bringing You our burdens. We come, God, with cares that for some of us this week have been too heavy to bear. Our hearts broken from sorrow or grief or suffering. Some loss that's very fresh and some, Lord, that happened years ago, but the weight of it still bears on us. And so we come again bringing it to You, knowing that You are the God of all comfort. And so I pray for those among us, God, whose hearts are heavy this day. I pray that You would lift them up. God, I also pray for us as a people gathered today. Some may be here exploring the truth claims of Jesus through His Word. And I pray that You would illuminate Your Word today beyond what I'm capable of. God, I know if anything good and lasting happens out of our time together, Holy Spirit, it will be because of You and You alone at work in us in this place. And so we come inviting You, Holy Spirit, to have unhindered sway here. You lead. We want to follow. God, as we sit underneath Your Word, we ask You to illuminate it, open our minds to it, and give us a spirit that says, God, whatever You will, we want that done. So, Father, I pray that You would hide me behind the cross of Christ, and that the power of Your Word and Your grace and mercy will be seen. Bless us in this time, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. And I invite you to have a seat. Glad you're here today. We have some folks traveling, I know. We've got a gang of folks that are traveling back from Folly Beach, our senior high youth who have been on their beach retreat this weekend. And I've already seen some of the results of that. Garrett kind of broadcast, sent me some videos and some pictures of what was taking place, and it was just so good to already hear that God has done a great work in the lives of our young people and is continuing to do that. But I will have to say that I miss them when they're not here. You know, some of you that have attended our 9:30 worship service know they sit here to start with, and they go through praise and worship before they go to their Bible study class, and then they exit, and then many of them will come back at the 11 o'clock and then sit here. And so they're this great cheerleading section for me. They smile at me. So y'all are going to have to smile more today. I'm just saying, you got to take up the slack with their absence. And again, I'm very grateful for that. Another thing I'm grateful for is an opportunity we have this afternoon to share, me and Pastor Dean, in our Exploring Church Membership Seminar. If you've been hanging out at Riverbluff for a little bit and thinking, I want to know more about the church, I want to understand why you do what you do the way you do, why you don't do it the way we did it at our last church, all that kind of stuff, we'll answer those questions very candidly. If I don't know the answer, I'll put Pastor Dean on. No, I won't do that. But we'll have a good time together, and so you can just show up today at 4 unless you need childcare, and then we need to know pretty quickly. So as you exit, you go ahead and sign up, and we'll check that out. But if you don't need childcare, you can just show up today at 4, and we'll walk with you through that. You'll have the opportunity to, at the end of the seminar, to join Riverbluff if that's something that the Lord has put on your heart. And but I hope you'll at least take the opportunity to explore that. Now, we have been in a study of the Epistle of James, and we're going to, you know what, I'm not even going to try to explain it. Get your Bibles out. I mean, I am going to explain it later. I'm not going to try to explain it to start with. Get your Bibles out. We're going to be in James chapter 5, verse 1. I will say this. James is about to use some very graphic imagery. Okay? This is, several commentators said, this is one of the most abrasive passages of Scripture in the New Testament. That's all the setup I'm giving it. Read with me. Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the misery that you are coming, for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasures in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. This is the word of the Lord. Aren't you so glad you came to Riverbluff today? That is kind of difficult stuff to swallow and digest, but it is the word of the Lord. You know, back at the beginning, actually before we even began this series, I said to Pastor Dean and to Garrett, I offered them opportunities to choose a couple of passages that they felt uniquely passionate about and wanted to teach. And I just don't understand why neither of them chose this passage. I don't get that. You know, one of the powerful truths about preaching straight through a book in the Bible is that you have to deal with these passages as we come to them. You know, we can't say we're studying the whole counsel of God if we get to James chapter 5 and read verses 1 through 6 and say, let's just jump to 7. You know, there's such a tendency in our hearts to do that. Now, those of you who have been here for a while know that I love to do topical preaching and I love to do verse-by-verse preaching. We do both of those here, and I'm not ashamed of either. I love doing both. But I could guarantee you that you're not going to find very many churches who decide, or even Riverbluff, who decide that we're going to do a series, you know, on how to have a deeper, more loving relationship with God, and this passage of Scripture show up in the teaching itinerary. It's probably just not going to be there. But what we just read was inspired by God. God wanted it in His Word, and God wants it in His Word. He wants it in His world and in our world. And so we need to attune our hearts to that. Now, we all love passages like, you know, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean on into your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your paths. Man, that's a sweet one, isn't it? But it is no more inspired than what we just read and what we're going to walk through. It's one of those inspired hard spots in the Scripture. You know, and I know that today's topic, which is materialism and money, I know today's topic is one of those topics that a lot of people think pastors shouldn't get in people's wallets. Well, I'm not trying to get there. Trust me. I want the Holy Spirit to do that. I don't want there. I want God there. And some people in church, leaders in churches sometimes get a little anxious when we talk about this and in this kind of setting, because we think, oh, those first-time guests are going to show up and they're going to think all these churches ever talk about is money, money, money. But if you're here today and you're a guest for the first time, I just want to say to you, apparently God had a bigger plan than you did or I did, because he knew it. And he has something to say from his word to all of us. Now, interestingly, Jesus, the one that we say we follow if we're Christians, of the 38 parables that Jesus spoke, those parables that Jesus spoke were those little stories that Jesus gave, little illustrations that Jesus gave for the express purpose of helping us understand how to live life in the kingdom of God. They were all about God's kingdom and life with him. And of those 38, 16 of those were specifically about finances and possessions and money. And so James is focusing on this, on the sin of materialism, which is a form of idolatry. And if you don't know what idolatry is, go read the first two of the Ten Commandments, because that's about idolatry. Both of those are about idolatry. So this is serious business that we're addressing today. And James is going to give us some massive warnings. And so in order for us to kind of land on the same page today, I want to give us some working definitions of both materialism and idolatry. And they're going to be very simple. You've heard better ones, more sophisticated ones. But I want us to be simple and to the point so we don't get mired down in the muck of some of that and miss out on what James wants to say to us. So to start with, here's a working definition of materialism that I want us to use for today's purposes. And it's a belief that money and possessions are the most important aspects of human existence. That money and possessions are the most important aspects of human existence. And that's what materialism is. Now, one of the things I'd probably be willing to bet on this, that there's nobody going to stand up in here today and say, yep, that's me, I'm a materialist. I'm eating up with materialism. It's not going to happen. I doubt if anybody online is going to say, yep, nailed it, that's me. We don't normally think of ourselves that way, because this is so hard to recognize and realize where it lands in us, that we think that somehow our existence is tied to this. But here's the truth in all of us. Slowly and surely, this begins to grip us. It becomes a problem in our lives. And that's why James is pointing this out to Christ's followers. See, the Bible, all throughout, actually pictures this issue. All throughout the whole Word of God. And this is one aspect of what the Word of God calls idolatry. So what is idolatry? Working definition. Idolatry is trusting more in a created thing than you do in the Creator. Trusting more in the thing that was created than in the Creator himself. So some people say, well, what does idolatry have to do with materialism? And I'm really, really glad you asked. Because if you're trusting in things that we have, in the accumulation of things that we have, like your portfolio or, you know, the vehicle you drive or the car, the house you live in, or, you know, the kind of image that makes you feel like you have because you own those things, the Bible would say that's the formation of idolatry. That's an idol. And idols are sneaky things. They just sneak up in our souls, you know. Here's kind of a diagnosis. If you spend very much time at all, you know, if you give much attention to, or some of your passion is over, or let's go the other way, if you stress about or you have angst over things like money and possessions, then James has a word for us today. And by the way, it's not just if you have a lot of things. It's also true for those who may not have a lot of things, because oftentimes they get wrapped up in materialism on the other side, focused on what they don't have, and they're stressed out and anxious at trying to get something. So, you know, one of the things that's interesting, it's not just if you're rich or if you desire to be rich. In fact, the Bible rarely talks about how much we have. What it always speaks to is our attitudes towards what we have. So before we jump into what James is saying here, I want us to clear up a couple of things. One of the things that we need to be clear on is that money in and of itself and possessions, they're not evil. Money and possessions are tools that God gives us to use here on this good earth. It's the way we use that tool that can turn it into an idol. Money itself is not evil. One of the most misquoted verses in the New Testament is from 1 Timothy chapter 6. And it starts out this way, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil." It's the love of money, not money. Money is a tool. But the love of money can turn it into this idol that leads to all kinds of evil. And notice how the verse goes on from 1 Timothy chapter 6. "And some people," and that's what we're talking about today, "some people craving money have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows." So this is about people who are people of faith who have wandered into this mess. And again, the focus word that James uses here is love. It's the love of money that gets us into trouble. The love of money is the difference between stewardship and idolatry. That's the difference. And James here is addressing what happens when money and possessions becomes an idol. And oftentimes in all of our lives, it makes its way there. And so because we're walking straight through James, we're going to deal with this today. And James is saying here, something that we need to dive into. Now, I hope your heart got captured by the first four words of James chapter 5. "Come now, you rich." Because some of you, when you read that, checked out. You said, "Well, that ain't me, babe, you know. So, Joe, go ahead and stick it to them rich people. You know, I'm ready now. I can check out and just be a bystander, a spectator, because you're not talking to me because I'm not rich." You're thinking, praise God, I'm off the hook today. Well, let me see if I can get you back on the hook, okay? If you've hung out at the river very long, you know we've talked about this before. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. In fact, you can actually go to a website called givingwhatwecan.org. And on givingwhatwecan.org, you can do a fun little exercise to kind of see where your income fits in comparison to people in the world. But just for, you know, fun games here, let me do this. If you make $25,000 a year, you go to this website, you plug that amount in, you will discover that you are better off than 93% of the 8 billion people in the world. At $25,000. You're in the top 7% of the world's rich. Congratulations, you're rich. I venture to say that there's nobody in here whose household income is below that. If it is, okay, you may be a little off the hook here. But let's go up just a little bit. If you make $50,000 a year, your household, you're in the top 2% of people as it comes to global wealth. 98.2% of people are worse off than you are financially. So when we look at how James starts this, and he says, "Come now, you rich," I think you're on the hook. I think you're there. We can't get off. And so James opens our mind's eye to this when we start thinking about it on a global way. And then he makes this strange statement about weeping and howling. You know, I'm probably not going to invite you to do that in a service anytime soon. But James is telling the rich, you need to think about weeping and howling. What's he talking about there? James is using some very, very strong language because he knows how this issue creeps into our souls. And he is trying to get our attention because when it creeps in, it starts shutting down our systems to resist and we succumb to it. And quite frankly, I believe we live in a culture that is saturated with the Affluenza outbreak. And it has made its way into the church, and it is a virus that has infected our souls. And James today is going to give us three warnings when we are living in an Affluenza outbreak. Truths from God's word, and they come right from the verses that we read. And the first warning that James gives us is this, I believe. James warns us that in an affluenza outbreak, we must recall that all worldly riches rot. Say that with me. All worldly riches rot. You're so glad you came to church today. You know, I know it. Just so encouraged. But see, James wants us to be captured by this. Look at verses 2 and 3. Your riches have rotted, and your garments are moth-eaten. What kind of garments get moth-eaten? The ones you wear? The ones that get pushed back in the closet that you don't wear? Those are the ones that get moth-eaten. So this is talking about somebody who just has extra stuff. So much stuff they don't even wear, it gets moth-eaten. It goes on. Your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. Again, James painting this graphic image that everything on the planet that isn't going to be sent to heaven, everything on the planet that's materialistic, everything on the planet that we can accumulate or consume at the end of the day, it's all going to corrode and rot. All of it. Now, I realize that's tough to hear because all of us, including me, we work hard for the things that we have. And the Bible tells us to work hard. It tells us to do that. So what is James doing here? James is pointing to what we're putting our trust in, the things that we strive to and struggle to accumulate, trying to seek happiness in them, are the things that are not going to provide what we think we're going to provide. And at the end of the day, all worldly riches rot. And Jesus himself said the very same thing, which shouldn't surprise us that his little brother would echo the words of his big brother. Jesus, in the great Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 and through 21, Jesus says this, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth or rust destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal." The verse doesn't end there. Here's the really important part of that verse that Jesus gets us to. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. See, James and Jesus are both saying to us that ultimately, what has a grip on our hearts, ultimately what we're putting our trust in and giving our passion towards, whatever you're doing that for, is truly kind of the master of your heart. And if it is something material, if it is money, it will rob your heart of life and joy. If you have that idol gripping your heart. James is reminding us here that even that which has a hold on your heart now, it's going to decay. So we need to let it go. And James, again, he's just perfectly agreeing with Jesus on this. And Jesus encourages us. Put our treasures in heaven. Don't look at stuff here on earth as ultimate reality or ultimate truth for our existence like so many in our culture and even in the church do. Those things are just a tool that God gives us. But we turn that tool into idols. Last Sunday, I mentioned an author that I love reading, Randy Alcorn. We talked for a moment a little bit about eternal rewards, and I commended a little book to you. I brought it this week. This really is a little book. I know some of you think, you know, it must have been a big book. It was a little book, easy to read little book. I highly commend this book to you. It's mostly scripture, and the book is entitled The Law of Rewards. Well, this week, I want to read you a quote from another book that Randy wrote. This is called Money, Possessions, and Eternity. This is what he says on these words from Jesus. Jesus is not speculating. He's speaking of sure things. He warns us not to store up treasures on earth, not because wealth might be lost. It's that wealth will definitely be lost. Either it leaves us while we live, or we leave it when we die. Has anybody already experienced in this life their stuff leaving them? Just kind of decaying, rotting, leaving you. All of us have. Let me see if I can prove it to you. 3 Christmases ago, there was something you wanted that you told, you know, either your parents you wanted, or you told a spouse you wanted, or you told coworkers you wanted. And you just felt like you had to have it, and people were sick and tired of hearing you talk about it. And you got it. What was it? What'd you get three Christmases ago? See, most people can't remember. Because stuff rots. It loses its luster. It goes away. It fades very quickly. That thing that you just had to have loses its power over us. The rot is already underway. That idea, you know, we think we need it and we get it, but it doesn't really satisfy. It never does for us what we thought it would do. And James is pointing out this darkness. I mean, think about something as simple as your phone. You know, you get that new phone, and you get it out of that new box, and you're all excited about your new phone. It's got all those new features, and you love your new phone until what happens? The next model is released. And then your new phone, that phone feels like a rotary dial phone. Because it doesn't have all those, you know, all those things, all those bells and whistles. Earthly riches rot. They lose their luster. James really goes after something here. Look at what he says in verses 2 and 3. Your gold and silver have corroded. Now, I love this for those of you who are science-minded, because you probably looked at that passage of scripture and says, does not. Gold is an incorruptible metal, Joe. It doesn't rust. I'm so excited that James chose to use that which we think of as incorruptible on earth to point to the corruptibility of it. And other commentators that I read pointed to do this, that this is the point that James is making, is that the thing that we think is impossible, that it'll never fail us in this earth, will. It will ultimately corrode and rot. It won't last. It's wasting away. And then in verse 3, James says, and their corrosion will be evidence against you. In other words, it's going to be like used in a court of law against you. And it says, and will eat your flesh like fire. These things are going to be evidence against us. And what James is saying here is, and this is sobering reality from Scripture, is, you know, that one day, you and I, and everybody for that matter, when we step into eternity, we're going to stand in judgment before a holy, righteous, sovereign God. And the Bible says that we are going to be judged. One of the things we're going to be judged for is what we did with what God gave us, with the tools God gave us. And we'll be judged for whether we use them as a tool or as an idol. But we're going to give an account on that day. And I thought about that a little bit this week, about how our culture just pursues stuff and materialism, and how we're going to give an account. And I thought about my own life. And the seasons and moments when my heart has been given over to the pursuit of stuff, of materialism. And I think about the numbers of people who their thought of going to heaven is, you know, is based on something than the mercy and grace of God found only in Jesus Christ, that they think somehow their portfolio is going to get them there, you know, that somehow that they drove a Tesla is going to get them there. And if you got a Tesla, I'm not bagging on you or anything like that. Maybe I'm jealous. Who knows? But if, you know, let me ask you a question. If you have a Tesla in your garage, is it bad? Is it bad? Well, the answer is maybe or maybe not. If you're trying to get your ultimate worth out of a driving machine, you're in trouble. You've turned it into an idol, so it's bad for you. But if it's just a tool that God has given you to get from point A to point B, well, praise God. Whatever we put our identity in or your worth in, so it could be your house or your, you know, 401k or whatever. Could be, if you're a gamer, you know, a lot of people like to build these big gaming systems now. If that's where you find your value, it's an idol. And it can become sinful. Anything can do that. You know, it just can. I know some of you iPhone users think that, you know, it's sinful to own any other phone other than, but my Android is just as good as your iPhone. You don't, you know, you got to come down. I know some of you are saying, no, it's not. I get these green bubbles when you, and I can't tell if you answered or read or, you know, when that happens. See, what matters is our attitude towards stuff. And James is painting this very, very clear picture that your worth and your value and your reputation cannot be tied to things, because when it does, it is going to eat your flesh like fire. It is going to destroy you from the inside out. And it will impact not just your very soul, but your whole being, your countenance, everything about you, because all worldly possessions rot. The Bible, again, clearly reminds us of this. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 7. I love this passage. It tells us, after all, we're brought into this world with nothing, you know, when we come in, and we can't take anything with us when we leave. And what that means, friends, is the poorest person on the planet and Elon Musk, when they enter into eternity. Now, Elon Musk owns Tesla, you know, and SpaceX and the social media formerly known as Twitter. But when he and the poorest person on the planet walk into eternity, guess what they're carrying with them? Nothing. Nothing of this earth. But people idolize him for his worth. And it's because we miss the beauty of everybody bearing the image of God because of stuff. It erodes our soul. It eats our flesh like a fire. Second warning that James gives us. James warns us that in an affluenza outbreak like we're living in, financial integrity matters massively. More so if we weren't in one. Financial integrity matters massively. That's what James is saying when we get to verse 4. He says, behold, the wages of the laborer who've mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. Now, obviously, what James was addressing was something that was going on uniquely in their culture. Here's that problem. People, owners of fields, were hiring day laborers to come and work in their fields, and they would get to the end of the day, and the owner would simply say, I didn't like the job you did. I ain't paying you. And they'd go. They'd have to leave. They had no, you know, no court to take this owner to. And what's going on is, in that owner's heart, they're just trying to accumulate more for themselves, so they're not paying a fair wage. They're not living so that both they and the workers could both benefit from that work. And James is saying it is wrong. And James is pointing out that integrity matters with money, with our possessions. And these landowners, did you notice what James called? He said they're committing fraud. They're literally breaking the law through fraud. Now, friends, whether you're dealing with a little bit of money or a lot of money, all of our financial dealings, you know, need to be with integrity. So how are you doing there? The things that God has given you, are you carrying them with integrity as Jesus followers? Now, we should have integrity in every area of our life. We should be the same no matter where we are or who we're with or anything like that. That's one of the prayers in my own life, that, you know, what you see here is what you get anywhere else. I pray that regularly because I know I can succumb to something else. But no matter the amount of money that you have or the possessions that you have, integrity with those things matters. I read a story this week. That a youth pastor, personal story that he shared with his youth group about a moment from his life when his dad took him, I think he was 7 or 8, something like that, his dad took him to a big box hardware store. They were working on a project, and the youth pastor shared this. He says, as we were getting ready to check out, there was a gentleman in front of us who had also checked out, and he was trying to put his money back into his wallet. My dad was kind of doing his thing at the checkout counter, and suddenly I saw the dollar bill fall to the ground that this man had dropped. And as he walked away, my first thought was, I've hit the jackpot. And as he walked away, I walked up and I picked up that dollar and I put it in my pocket. I was so excited that I got this dollar that once we got to our truck, I pulled it out just looking at it, not believing that the God of heaven had given me this dollar. And he went on to say, I don't even know the God of heaven at this time, but anyway. He said, but my dad sees him and goes, what's that? And I tell him, this guy that was in the store dropped it, and when he walked away, I picked it up. And I'm thinking about what I might get with it. He said, goes on to say, on this day, I couldn't tell you what the project was that I was working on with my dad. Ultimately, it didn't matter, but I still remember what my dad said next. He said, son, that's wrong. You should have told that man that he dropped it, and you should have given it back to him. But since we don't know where that guy is right now, since he's gotten in his truck and has driven away, here's what you're going to do, because integrity matters. You're going to go back to the counter at the hardware store, and you're going to tell them the story about this man dropping this, and that this dollar does not belong to you, and that you need to give it to the hardware store. Friends, those kinds of moments in our lives are moments to hear from God, to learn. And so let me ask you a quick question. What right now in your life is that drop dollar? What right now in your life may be a financial decision that's a little on the shady side, or maybe you're trying to take a shortcut, and maybe this message, the intensity of what James is pointing to us today, is your opportunity with God to go back to God, God's counter of grace, and say, it's not mine. It doesn't belong to me. You take it. Maybe that's what today is about for you. Now, you know, I know that moments like these are not moments we want to celebrate. This is a hard passage from the Word of God. But we can't skip over it. We need to embrace it. We need to engage with it. Because remember how verse 4 ends. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. Now, I want to just take a moment to give a quick word to anybody who feels like they've been on the bad end, maybe got burnt because of somebody else's shadiness, somebody else's dealing, somebody else's swindling. Right now, your heart is heavy about being maybe a victim there. Maybe right now you're in a work environment and you're under a boss and you're an employee and you're crying out to God that what's going on is wrong. Well, here's what I would encourage you to do. Keep crying out to God that it's wrong. See, because God hears your prayers. God is the God of justice. He wants justice to come. He wants it to roll in like a mighty river. So you keep crying out to the Lord of hosts. You keep praying for that, because the Bible, James tells us here, he hears you. He hears you. He's listening. He knows the cry of your heart here. So keep doing that. James's third warning that helps us fight this sin of materialism, this affluenza outbreak. We must become aware that this affluenza, materialism, actually alters our reality. It will actually alter our ability to see reality. When we're caught up in the sin of materialism, the reality is it just keeps growing, and it keeps replicating in us, just like a virus does in our body. It keeps being fed, and it keeps beginning to distort our health, our soul's health. So, you know, you say, Joe, where's that in the text? Give me just a second, I'll get there. But I want to show you two ways that this alters your reality. The first way that it alters your reality is it alters the way you see yourself. This affluenza alters how you see yourself, how I see myself. Look at verse 5. James writes, you have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. This is just the idea that if you're just consuming, accumulating, you know, all that, this is where it leads. You have fattened your heart in a day of slaughter. If our reality is we just keep consuming and taking in and pursuing to accumulate, James points out it's a process that it's easy to kind of slip into. Now, if you are a vegetarian or a strong member of PETA. You're probably not going to like this next illustration, but James, this is what James is doing here. James talks about fattening our hearts for a day of slaughter. So what exactly does that mean? Well, he's alluding to a process that cattle ranchers use in order to get, that steak on your plate at Texas Roadhouse, or that burger on your grill, fired up really tasty and, you know, juicy. When I was a kid growing up, my great uncle Oswald, who lived just outside of Barnwell, he raised cows and hogs, and we would go up there during the summer sometimes on his farm. And one of the things that all cattle ranchers will do is, as the cow is getting ready to be sold, they will start feeding them more. I read this week. Did you know that a cow can eat about 4% of its current weight in a day? So you take a 1,000-pound cow, you can feed him about 40 pounds of feed in a day. He can consume that. And he's getting fatter and fatter and fatter because the cattle farmer, the cattle rancher, knows that what's going to happen is he's going to get more at the market based on the more weight this cow gains in his last days. And so this cow is just consuming, accumulating, but the cow has no idea why. He thinks, the farmer loves me. He just loves me, and he's just being so good to me, and he just keeps feeding me and feeding me. But what's he doing? He's fattening him for the slaughter. And the cow's unconcerned. He's oblivious to what's really going on. His reality is distorted. But he just keeps consuming. James is warning us that we are just like that in our fight with the sin of materialism. When we're tempted to be greedy and we get caught in this consumer kind of mentality, and we get a raise and we think, how am I going to spend it on myself? Or we get a bonus, and we don't go to God with those things. We don't think about, how can I be generous with this? And we become unfazed by it too. And unconcerned. And what's really going on is our soul is being fattened for a day of slaughter. Satan is seeking to kill and steal and destroy your very soul, to erode you from the inside out. The second way that it distorts our reality is, affluenza not only alters how I see myself, but it alters how I see others. Listen to how James concludes this line of thinking in verse 6. You have condemned and murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. Now, there are a couple of times throughout the book of James where he makes this reference to murder. And, you know, we really don't know whether it's because he's pointing out that a murder has actually occurred by somebody in the church of Jerusalem or what. We don't know. But whether he's talking about this from the standpoint of things like anger in your heart leads you to murder somebody's reputation. But no matter what James is pointing to is this sin of idolatry, this that's wrapped around materialism, destroys others. Because you no longer see people as bearers of the image of God. What you see them is a problem to get out of the way so you can accumulate more. And when we don't fight this sin of materialism, when we don't deal with this affluenza outbreak in our own souls, we're tempted to give in to more greed. And people become these obstacles and these problems. You know, whether that's an employee or a friend or a spouse, you know, we just want what we want. And it murders, it destroys relationships. And I've seen it happen. I've seen the pursuit of materialism destroy and tear apart marriages, destroy relationships between parents and children. And God knows that, and James is pointing this out to us. So how do we make application to all this? You know, how do we take this that James is talking about, how do we plug it into our lives today? Because that's what we want the Word of God to do. We want the Word of God to bear weight on us. And so we need to think about application on this. And in order to do that, especially in this issue, you got to be honest before God. You got to get really honest before God with your own life as it relates to materialism and the proper place of money and possessions. You got to reflect deeply on this. And so here's what's not going to happen. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand right now. Some of you went, whew. And I'm not going to ask you to get in small groups and confess sin. Not going to do that at the moment. But friends, while money is a great gift, it can be a great gift, money is a wretched God. And if you make it that, it will destroy your soul. And maybe today is the opportunity for you to open up to God and say, God, I want you to deal with this in my life. I want you to deal with this in the hard imagery that James gives us. God, I want to do what your word calls me to do in this area of my life. God, I want to put my money and my possessions in its proper place. So how do we do that? Well, we have to regularly do self-evaluation of our heart, because none of us are immune to the pandemic of affluenza that's in our culture and that has crept into the church. See, we can't stand back and just say, never had a problem with materialism. That's like saying you never had a problem with gossiping or always speaking the truth, you know, or never getting angry. I've seen you drive on Dorchester Road. And you've seen me, you know. We've got to do a true evaluation. And that starts by dealing with some true questions, you know. And we go to God and we say, you know, God, am I putting any sort of hope or identity or trust or value of myself in things, possessions? Do I find myself fearing overwhelmingly because I lack in something like that? I don't have something somebody else has. God, am I living that way? Is that true of my soul? Am I putting hope? And the Holy Spirit, He'll walk you through these things. He'll help you see the truth in this, because the Holy Spirit wants to point out where our souls are unhealthy. Another question, since, you know, you want to be honest before God, is, you know, has materialism in any way, shape, or form gripped your heart? Ask God to show you, point out any evil way in you on this, you know? Is there something going on in your mind? Has it maybe altered your reality and you can't even see clearly? Is your heart being fattened by Satan for a day of slaughter? Maybe right now the Holy Spirit's nudging you. Don't ignore that. Don't just blow it off. One last question. How are you doing when it comes to your money and walking in integrity? Or is today your hardware store day and you need to walk back to the counter and say, God, it's not mine. I took this from somebody else. God, I'm giving it back today. I may not be able to find that person, but God, I'm giving it back to you. God, would you take it? See, the only way forward in our faith is to surrender, give up our idols, to just open our hands and say, God, I want to walk in integrity with my money and my possessions. And God, I want to start with you. I want to start with you, God. I'm going to ask our worship team if they'll begin making their way back to the stage. See, that's the starting place of walking in financial integrity, is to do it with God. So what does that look like? Because, you know, I told you, the Bible talks about this a lot in a lot of places. And the Bible is so plain and clear about if we're going to walk in integrity with God in our finances, there's some things we got to engage. I'm going to move through these quickly. Malachi chapter 3, starting in verse 8, says this. God speaking through the prophet, you people are robbing me, your God. And here you are asking, how are we robbing you? And God says, you are robbing me of the offerings and of the 10% that belongs to me. I'm the Lord, all powerful, and I challenge you to put me to the test. Bring the entire 10% into the storehouse, and the storehouse is the place where you worship. Then I will open the windows of heaven, and I will flood you with blessing after blessing. God says, test me in this. See if that won't be true. In Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9, God says, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first and best of all your income. Leviticus chapter 27, verse 30, God says, 10% of everything you produce is holy and belongs to me. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 23, Jesus is actually speaking to religious leaders of his day, and he says, yes, you should tithe. You know, I've had people tell me, Jesus never talked about tithing. How many times does Jesus have to say something before you're going to believe it? You know how many times Jesus said you must be born again? Once. But man, Baptists love that one. We run from this yes, you should tithe thing, but we love that must be born again thing. You know, we can't pick and choose here. The Apostle Paul, writing to Christ's followers at the Church of Corinth, says, on every Lord's Day, every first day of the week, Lord's Day, each of you should put aside something from what you have earned during the week, use it for this offering. The amount depends on how much the Lord has helped you earn. And then this is my favorite verse in the scriptures about tithing. Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 23. I love the way the Living Bible translates this. The purpose of tithing is to teach you always to put God first in your life. Friends, God does not need your money. But if you want to walk in integrity, if you want the grip of materialism to lose its grips and tentacles on you, if you want to be loosed from that, the starting place is to walk in integrity with God. See, while God doesn't need your money needs the blessing of God on it. God's purpose for tithing is not related to money. It's because he's looking for your heart. And God knows one of the things that's true about the human heart while it's on this planet is it's going to follow the trail of money. And so Jesus says, where your heart is, you know, where's your heart? See, God is for your heart. God's great desire is to have your total trust in him. He wants you and me to wholeheartedly love him. And so he desperately wants to cure us from this pandemic of materialism and this idolatry. That's heavy on God's heart. And the way that James communicated this was just powerful. The heart of God for you. Let's pray. Lord, we come in this moment. We come having sat before your word, having sat under it and having felt the weight of it in our own lives. Lord, we want to be set free from this captivity. We want to be set free, God, from this fattening that Satan is doing in our hearts, trying to lead us to a day of destruction. God, we want to step out of and from under that authority and come back to you. And to walk in integrity before you and with you, oh God, with our resources, with our finances, with our possessions. God, we come again this day being reminded that it's all yours. But you have especially called us, your people, to set aside some, and you've made it holy for you. Father, I pray for us now. I pray, God, that we would choose this day to make ourselves completely available to your purposes, to take all of our resources, our material possessions, and make them available to your plans and purposes, oh God. Making all of our lives available to you. And maybe you're here today, and you have felt the weight of materialism pressing down on you. You have felt the strangulation of that idol in your own life. You know them as creditors calling on your phone. And today, the Lord is saying to you, I want all of you. I want you to make all of yourself available to me. And maybe you're here today, and that's the first step you need to make. You need to say, Jesus, all of me is available to you. My life, my thoughts, my values. God, I want your values to be mine. I want your thoughts to be mine. I want your ways to be mine. I give up trying to run my life. The Bible says if you call on the name of the Lord that way, in surrender, you'll be saved. Lord, we come again, afresh, all of us needing to make ourselves fully available to you in one way or the other, needing to make our stuff, our possessions, our finances, wholly available to you. Lord, we come hearing your call. And right now, Lord, our hearts want to say, God, you can have it all. Take it all, Lord. We come to worship now. We come to thank you. We come to praise you. We come to recommit ourselves to you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask you, if you would, to stand and join our praise team as they lead us to recalibrate on making ourselves available to the Lord, all of us, everything we have. Let's worship him.
Oh,
I hope, my prayer has been for myself and for you, that that phrase that we sang, you can have it all, you can have it all, Lord, you can have it all, you can have it all, would be our heart's cry, would be our prayer as we encountered God's word today. Because giving God your all is the best place to be. He knows that. So he has designed his kingdom that way. And his promise is, when you give it all back to him, he returns it blessed. So you don't want, you want to try to keep fixing it yourself, or you want the God of all creations to bless. Because he wants to do that. And he wants you to let others know about him and how great his grace is and his mercy and his love. So let him have it all. God bless you. And I hope to see you soon. Maybe this afternoon at 4:00.